Hello and welcome to Beyond the Boundary. This is the 2014 Grand Final and Season Review. I've got Nick to my right, as always. How are you, mate?
I'm absolutely brilliant. Josh, how are you?
I'm a little flat, to be honest. The season's done.
It is, but your Hawker's got up, so I'm sure you're happy about that.
Renee, how are you, buddy?
I'm good, Josh. It's been a roller coaster of a year, but we're here in the last show and we're going to have a good look at the Grand Final.
Yep.
And what went wrong and what went right.
Absolutely. Well, Let's kick it off with the result. No one, I don't think, picked Hawthorn by 10 goals.
I don't think many people were picking Hawthorn to stop, to be honest. You did, credit to you.
I did as well. We picked them by a point.
In the end? No, I'm pretty sure.
No, I seesawed back and forth, ended up picking Sydney.
Yeah, but ended up going with Sydney.
Well, there you go. I get another tip right again.
But the key thing was everyone thought it was going to be a close game. Yep. Nobody saw this blowout coming. And Hawthorn, just from the word go, were just absolutely electric.
Absolutely. I mean, a lot of people said it was the most boring game they've seen since the 2007 Grand Final.
Most boring Grand Final I've seen since 2007, but for Hawthorn supporters, probably not.
Well, you say that, and you're going to take the piss out of me anyway, but the way Hawthorn played, I felt it made an attractive game to watch.
Yeah, Hawthorn played a brand of football, definitely. If you were backing Hawthorn in, I can certainly see that, but the Grand Final, you sort of come in hoping for that contest, hoping for that spectacle, and as a neutral supporter, I just didn't see that, but I do see that.
Well, as a neutral supporter, I found it a fantastic game to watch, just because the level of football that Hawthorn played against a quality opposition.
It's probably a fair point. What do you think, Bidet?
Yeah, I thought, I'll be honest, I didn't really think it was a very thrilling Grand Final. I thought it was good to watch Hawthorn play well, but that's not what you watch Grand Finals for. I mean, I think a Grand Final, the purpose of it is to see two very good teams fight it out tooth and nail to the last, you know, at least for half the game.
Yeah. Yep.
And this game was probably dead and buried by halftime. So it was, you know, it was disappointing, especially after all the build-up and all the... But, you know, having said that, you know, the players don't go out there to entertain us. They go out there to win, you know, what means a lot to them. Probably what their whole lives build up to, something like that. But having said that, like I said, Hawthorn was excellent. And it was good to see a side play so well. But on the other hand, I think Sydney honestly had their worst game for the year. Well, apart from their game against
Sydney. I was going to ask you, boys. There was talk coming up to the game that Sydney's plane was having trouble getting out of Sydney. It was the bad weather or something like that. There was delays. I question whether that plane ever made it to Melbourne, because watching that game on Saturday, Sydney just did not turn up.
Speaking of the Swans, boys, let's have a few look at their players.
We'll start with the bad.
Yep.
And the downright ugly. I think for the Swans.
Better clinic. the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Luke Parker, I'm going to start with. He wasn't absolutely horrendous.
He wasn't their worst player, no.
But going into that game, he was my tip for the Norm Smith. He was Vinay's tip for the Norm Smith. He's come off a best on ground performance the week before. He's finished this game with 20 touches. 13 of those were handballs. Couldn't get a foot in that game at all.
Yeah, he just didn't have the impact that he's been having all year, to be honest. Maybe the occasion got to him. He played as a sub in 2012, so he was able to adjust to the scenery and stuff like that.
Yep.
Who knows, maybe he struggled to adjust to the climate of the game and maybe he got overawed by the occasion.
Oh, look, I thought he started off very well. He didn't look to have any issues at the start of the game.
Yep.
But Sydney did not win enough of the ball. And that, he was a victim of that. He just didn't get enough of the ball. But you think about 20 disposals in the context of his team was actually pretty good.
In the context of his team, but he's the man that you would look to stand
up. But I think I don't think it's right for Sydney to look to a third-year 21-year-old to stand up.
Yeah.
I think that's unreasonable.
Probably a victim of his own form and expectations.
Yeah. Well, Luke Parker, how much of a star he is, he's not the one that should have stood up. The ones that should have stood up to me are the guys like Jared McVeigh, Lewis Jetta, guys that have played in Grand Finals.
Jared McVeigh will touch on now. He finished with 11 touches.
Yeah.
I said to you boys last week, he was the only player that could have improved after that prelim final performance, because he had a similar amount of touches the week before as well. And he just didn't. He probably played worse.
Yeah, well, he was very average, and Lewis Jetta's another one.
Yeah.
I'll go as far to say that he's the most overrated player in the AFL. I don't see what people see in this guy. I mean, he runs fast.
Yep.
But you look at Rioli and Jetta, and the reason I'm looking at these two is because they play similar roles. They're playmakers. They're guys that put on a lot of pressure with their tackle. They're supposed to.
Yep.
They've got good pace to run and carry with the ball. You look at the amount of pressure and tackling that Rioli did, and he got subbed off.
Yep.
Jetta played all four quarters. Granted, he went off for a little while.
Yep.
But Rioli just had him for breakfast. Jetta was insipid, and he has been for the most part of this year. I will go as far to say that. The only game I can remember him playing well was against West Coast. Apart from that, he's just been shocking this year. He's not put on any pressure, Josh. He's not tackling the way he should. He's not using his pace to break the lines.
Yep.
He's not hitting targets with his kicks. He's had four touches for the entire game. Craig Bird, the sub, came on more, like probably halfway through the third term and had eight for the game. He played the entire game and he's had four disposals. There are some serious issues. And I tell you what, Lewis Jetta, he's just, I'm not sure what people see in him.
Very disappointing.
Before we get into the good players for the Swans as well, Gary Rowan had a very good game against North Melbourne.
Probably his best game of his career the week before.
Absolutely. Sam Reed came in with a bit of an injury, but he played the game, so you assume he was fit. Another one we haven't got here is Ben McGlynn as well. Ben McGlynn had, I think, 13 touches it was. So it just wasn't to be Sydney's day.
Well, you think about it, like Parker McVeigh, you mentioned McGlynn. They're all guys that always feature in the best.
Yep.
And yet today on the, you know, the big dance, I think you call it, they've all featured in the bad, which is just...
Yep. On the other side of the coin, there were three players standouts in an otherwise underwhelming Sydney side. Yeah. The first one would have to be Nick Malcheski. He finished that game with 10 rebound 50s. He was all over the place. Made a couple of silly mistakes in the first quarter, which were really costly for Sydney. But other than that, played a very solid game.
Well, it's ironic, isn't it?
What?
It's ironic the fact that Nick Malcheski was one of their best and the fact that he probably won't even be at the club next year.
Well, that's the little rumour flying around, but I'm not surprised he had 10 rebound 50s, to be honest, because I think at one stage the inside 50 count was 30-8.
Yeah, I think he played extremely well, though, in the sense that he positioned himself very well.
Yep.
He read the play extremely well, and I think Hawthorn could have got away with a lot more goals if it wasn't for this man plonking himself in all the right places.
Yep. Josh Kennedy, of course, is another one. Finished the game with 5 clearances, kicked the first goal of the day. He was pretty impressive.
He started really well. I think he got 5 touches within the first 3 minutes.
Including
the running goal. So
yeah.
He was absolutely fantastic. He said he had 15 contested possessions. So he's one player that can hold his head high.
Yep.
And the last one, Lance Franklin. He was the man all the focus was on that day. 5 marks, all 5 of them were contested. He kicked 4 goals too. Also finished with 5 clangers, so doing a bit of everything.
Don't worry about those uncontested marks, Josh. We won't be worrying about them at all.
Because he didn't take any.
Because he didn't take any. He had 5 marks and all of them were contested. He kicked, I think, clangers. Behinds count as a clanger, don't they?
Do they?
I'm quite sure they do.
I'm not certain on that, but anyway.
All right, in any case, because he always ends up finishing with a lot of clangers, Lance Franklin.
Yep.
And it occurs to me that he always kicks a lot of behinds. But
well, he's that kind of player that takes the high-risk option every time. So, you know, high-risk, high-reward.
Yep.
If it pays off, it's most likely to end up in a goal, whether by an assist or a kick for goal yourself.
I feel bad for Buddy because he worked extremely hard to kick those goals. He serviced himself to a great extent. He worked for his ball. Brian Lake actually did a reasonable job on him.
Yep.
When you consider that all 5 of Franklin's marks were contested, you can't have a go at Lake for that.
Yep.
He's done his job and marked him well. So... I don't know. I mean, it's not usual that you see a guy kick, 4 goals?
Well, I was going to say, to finish with 4 goals in a grand final, I think in the last decade or 15 years or something like that, 4 goals is the most anyone's kicked in a grand final. So for him in a losing side, a comprehensively beaten losing side, to still end up with 4 goals, he's absolutely made the most of the limited supply that he did get from his Sydney teammates. Moving on to Hawthorn.
On a brighter note,
we will start.
There we go, look at this.
Just to take the piss out of you two.
He was wearing that all day on Saturday, don't you worry.
And he also had his Hawks jumper on.
Hawks. No, I
didn't. And he ran out with the boys.
Right.
If you look closer, you can see Sam Mitchell carrying you to the ground.
Just to take the piss out of you two.
We'll start with 2-time Norm Smith medalist Luke Hodge. Josh, what did you think of his game?
The guy I predicted for the Norm Smith.
No, the guy Josh predicted for the Norm Smith.
He steps up. He steps up on the big occasion.
He's definitely a big game player.
He's a big game player, all right. I'm not going to say anything bad about him because he's won at Norm Smith. He's side won the granny, so there's nothing I can say.
He's won two.
All right, okay. All right.
12.
What do you want to say to him?
I don't want to say anything. I just want to say that he's a good leader and he's a good player. Let's move on.
You want to say something?
No, I don't want to say anything.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
Come on, bro.
Now, all I'm saying is that Luke Hodge, he turns up on the days that count.
Yeah.
But this man's role is, for a lack of a better word, not that difficult. He plays largely as a loose player. The whole game I watched, he played as a loose player. There were a number of times where he took uncontested junk time marks and just kick to kick.
That's
with Josh Gibson.
Problem,
that 30, is not his problem. I'm not saying that's a bad thing.
35 disposals, just 10 of those were contested.
I'm not saying that's a bad thing at all.
Yeah.
But I honestly feel that if it wasn't his 250th, he would not have won that Norm Smith because there was a man called Jordan Lewis
250th
that had a much more influential game than him.
I don't think he's...
And this is reminiscent of 2011, I believe, where Joel Selwood was robbed of the Norm Smith. by Jimmy Bartel. And this is exactly what I'm seeing here. Jordan Lewis has this time been robbed. The two boys from Geelong.
We'll get to Jordan Lewis in a moment. Luke Hodge was obviously very good.
He was good. Nothing against Hodge. He's a gun, but I'm just saying.
Yep. 12 marks, 4 tackles, 4 clearances, 4 inside 50s. Yep. Terrific game of football, whichever way you look at it. Sam Mitchell, we will get to Jordan Lewis for that. Yes, Sam Mitchell finished with 9 marks, 9 tackles, 7 clearances. He was absolutely terrific.
He finished second in the Norm Smith medal behind Hodge.
That is ridiculous.
But it was fantastic. We said time and time again, we don't know which one his preferred foot is.
Well, he took a mark both 50 metres out.
Both so damaging.
And went with his left foot, even though he's a right footer.
Yeah. Yep. Well, it's a matter of debate which foot he actually uses. Which we're debating the other way. Jordan Lewis, for now, you thought he was very good.
Oh, come on. 37 touches, 14 contested, 8 marks, 7 clearances, 5 inside 50s, and 7 rebound 50s. And he had 8 hitouts.
Eight hitouts. We talked about this last week.
He was a better ruckman than Tom Bell Chambers on the day.
Hawthorn love their third man up midfielders.
They do.
Jordan Lewis, 8 hitouts.
No, like, but what I'm saying here is he's had 7 clearances as an inside mid, right? 5 inside 50s as an attacking mid, 7 rebound 50s as a defensive mid, and 8 hitouts.
I'm just absolutely amazed. That's a significant tally of hitouts.
This is just unbelievable. I cannot believe that he
didn't. Anyway, moving on. Will Langford. I thought he was another man who probably wasn't too far off.
He was fantastic. I think he had 21 disposals, 3 goals.
6 tackles. How about that goal from the boundary?
He got the perfect bounce, didn't he?
I'll tell you what. I don't like to take away from the young kid, but if I was there, I would have held
it.
It was on target. But I'll tell you what, Josh.
Anyway,
oh boy.
We'll race through a couple of others who are very good. Luke Bruce, 5 tackles, 5 inside 50s, 3 goals. He was great. Yep. Ben Stratton went at 82% efficiency, had 5 marks. He played a great cameo role for them. Sean Burgoyne, I thought, was very good, 92%
efficiency. How about him for the Smith?
He was very, very good.
And 92% efficiency.
He didn't get a vote.
I tell you what, the people on the Norm Smith panel, there's something wrong with them.
Well, one was Nathan Buckley.
Idiot. Next.
Cameron Lee.
Come next. On, We'll have to get Vinay on the panel next year.
I'll tell you what.
The last one worth a mention, Jared Ruffhead, 5 marks.
Big Ruff.
5 goals. He was great for Hawthorn.
Look at Josh. Look how excited he is, Nick.
Now, I wanted to put it to you. Cyril Rioli was probably the only player I could see on that ground who was underwhelming for me. The only player I could pick out who wasn't very good, but Josh thinks he was great.
I didn't say he was great.
Okay. What do you think he was?
I said he was good.
He was good.
He was good.
I don't think he was good.
No?
Why? I think it was terrible. I think he laid some good pressure acts. I think he had
one... A lot of perceived pressure.
I think he cut off a handball well, which ended up leading to a goal.
Oh, he also tackled Malcheski in the back half, and that wasn't a free kick. Should have been one.
I don't know. I've seen a very underwhelming... I think if Sydney had have turned up, this could have proved to be a not-so-good decision. Obviously, we'll never know, because Hawthorn have absolutely dominated them, and they could have had 18 players in total, and they probably still would have won. But, you know... I just didn't think he was that good at all.
What was your return there, Josh? What's your return?
I thought he was very good, to be honest, because some stats don't get counted with things he does.
Perceived pressure.
What is with this taking the piss out of me?
Go ahead. It's every week. So some stats, like the 1%ers, well, they do get counted, but you're talking about the pressure acts and things like that.
The pressure acts and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, in that first quarter, he set the tone. He's made a number of tackles, as he said, on Malcheski that wasn't rewarded.
Yeah.
He put on a lot of pressure on those Sydney defenders to force kicks, ineffective kicks down the line.
Yeah.
I thought he was good. To put him in the bad category, I think he's a bad call.
He's the only one. It's probably unfair, but he's the only one I can pick out who was a bit underwhelming.
I thought he was quite good. I thought he was definitely not bad. I don't think he was great, but he was. He did. I think Clarkson would have given him a very specific role.
Yeah.
He would have said, "It doesn't matter if you don't kick goals, but do what you do, which is run as hard as you can."
I think the key point here is that he was selected over Jonathan Simpkin. I think Jonathan Simpkin could have had a much bigger impact.
But what I'm saying is that
Simpkin would have been the sub regardless.
Yes. And also another thing you've got to consider is, as the opposition coach, the name Cyril Rioli will strike a lot more fear into their heart than the name Jonathan Simpkin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because Rioli is a guy that you have to make accountable. You have to put someone on him. You've got to dedicate a proper defender to him.
Anyway, boys, we'll move on to our season predictions.
Just one quick thing. Sorry.
Oh, before you wrap up.
Before we do go on, Ben McAvoy, I thought, was a very good selection.
Ben McAvoy was another one, actually. Looking MC. At that selection coming into the game, I thought that could have almost made a make or break the side. Because Jonathan Segler was very... don't know, it was a very academic call to try and take him out and put the big name Ben McAvoy in, because I thought Seguar's obviously been the better player all year. So it could have made Coughlin look a little bit silly, but obviously it hasn't.
He was good, big boy.
He was good, yep.
The MC.
Definitely played his role well. Anyway, we're going to move on to our season predictions. We're going to look back at our preseason predictions, which we did in March or February, wherever it was. Have a look at who has fared best. The ladder predictions, boys. We'll start with mine. I was 34 spots combined out, ladder positions that is. I think the big one, Richmond top four, Port Adelaide 13th. A little bit of a miss there.
Just a bit.
Josh, 32 spots out. You had Geelong 7th, which they ended up finishing 3rd. Don't know what's going on there.
My gap's a bit closer than yours.
You also had Port Adelaide down in 10th. Vinay, 36 spots out, so Josh has fared the best.
Hang on, have I won something again, have I?
Josh, shut up, Josh. I think my biggest blunder was Collingwood. They absolutely took me out the back and shot me between the eyes.
Well, three quarters of the way through the year.
I looked good, didn't I? I looked the goods. But
you had them third. They finished, what was it, 11th?
11th. Bit so of that, a blunder that, is there. That is a kick in the pants, boys, is what that is.
None of us had Port Adelaide in the act. So that has been the one big surprise for us all there.
I'll be having them as my grand finalists at the moment.
me too, to be honest. Now the grand finalists and premiers, I tipped Sydney to beat Fremantle. Obviously it hasn't happened. Josh has tipped Sydney to beat Hawthorn. Picked the grand finalists correctly. But Vinay, pre-season, tipped Hawthorn to be premiers over Sydney. Well done to you, Vinay. The Brownlow,
I got something right.
The Brownlow, I tipped my boy Joel Selwood, who finished 4th on 21 votes. And I tipped Boak as the Ruffy, who tied in 4th, also on 21 votes. So not too far.
Isn't it interesting that me and Josh both foresaw Sydney and Hawthorn to make the grand final, but then in the eve of the grand final, I tipped Sydney and he tipped Hawthorn.
Yeah, I thought that was quite funny as well.
That's pretty funny. But I'm the one who won it, Josh, so let's not get too ahead of ourselves here.
Josh has tipped his favourite player, Patrick Dangerfield, for the Brownlow pre-season. He's also finished 4th on 21 votes. And his roughie was Tom Brockley, who finished 8th on 15, but had a very good season and probably a couple of votes under what a lot of people would have expected.
He did get suspended a couple of times.
Did get suspended a couple of times. Vinay has gone the easy call and tipped Gary Ablett, who finished 3rd on 22 votes. And his roughie was Fife, who finished 2nd on 25 votes. So I reckon Vinay has fared the best with the Brownlow tips.
You've got to use this one up here, Josh. That's what you've got to use.
I don't have much up there.
Even though Fife was ineligible, so maybe it won't count for you.
No, fair enough.
The Coleman, I've got a bit of a big head here.
Well, here we go, Josh.
Of
course.
He's
Ruffy.
Yeah, he's Ruffy.
Anyway, I've tipped Buddy, who has won the
Coleman. Yeah, that's fair.
Credit to you. My Ruffy was Jared Rufford, who won the Coleman
2013.
I think we better clarify the definition of Ruffy the next season, boys. Because he was my outside chance. I was quite confident Franklin would be.
Outside chance? He won the damn thing last year. How's that an outside?
Anyway,
he was inside chance.
Second, so it's hardly across to me.
I'll tell you what, Nick.
Josh, what's going on? Jack Riewoldt.
Who finished with 50 plus?
I don't know.
It wasn't an absurd pick. I think at times he showed his brilliance. He was one of the very few forwards. I think he only went one game the whole year without a goal. Yeah. He kicked a goal in every single game of the
consistent
year.
I'll give him that.
Consistently, yes.
Jack Darling was your roughie. Who was...
I've just got a man crush on that guy, so that's why I picked him.
Well, he actually played half forward most of the year, so that's...
No doubt. Vinay has picked Cloak for his Coleman.
He finished with 39 goals.
I'll tell you what, Travis Cloak, the year that I picked him to have the Coleman, he has his worst year since he debuted Coleman. It was just a shocking year for poor Travis.
And of course he's picked his own man, Josh Kennedy.
No,
as the roughie.
That's not his name.
King Kennedy.
Thank you. And he finished with the second highest goals per game average in the NFL.
Oh, yeah, clutching at straws
that's right.
The rising star. We've missed the mark here, boys. I'll be the first to say that.
You've missed the mark. At least our two got nominations.
Bugger off. I've tipped Luke McDonald for the rising star. Moving on. Shane Kirsten was my roughie.
McDonald finished third.
Where'd
Shane Kirsten finish, Josh?
Nowhere.
Nominated.
At least he didn't say Josh Caddy.
Granted, Kirsten was injured for a fair chunk of that season.
All right, fair enough.
Kicked 4 goals on debut.
Yep.
Josh had Matt Crouch, who had a pretty good season.
Yep. He's in there on the side.
His roughie was Zach Merritt, who was at least nominated. We'll give you that.
He had a very good year. Should have got a vote.
Oh, for sure.
Watching every single one.
Vinay also went with Luke McDonald, and James Aish was his roughie, so not too far off there either.
Wobble? Was I the only one who had both players who actually polled a vote?
Probably,
Wobble.
Well done to you. Now we'll move on to our big calls.
Oh, no.
And we haven't done very well here either, but we're going to cop it on the chin.
Oh, that's all right. Boys, I might just head out now.
I'll start. We'll get to you in a minute, Josh, because I've got to have a word to you about it. But I'll start. We pride ourselves on making the big calls on Beyond the Boundary. Sometimes we get them right. Sometimes, like in this case, we haven't. Big call number one for me was Dawson Simpson to be regarded as one of the top three best rucksmen in the competition.
Nick, let's first of all confirm, clarify.
Yep.
We made these calls
in February.
And they're big calls. We didn't go for calls that we're quite certain will happen.
Yeah.
We went with calls that we were quite certain wouldn't happen. And that's why we chose them. Because they're big calls.
Big calls.
Yes,
big calls.
Because we're certain they wouldn't happen, but we still felt there was this chance they could.
A slight chance. Anyway, Dawson Simpson, I made this call with the assumption they'd be the number one ruck because I had no faith. I had no faith in Hamish McIntosh playing out a full season. Simpson, he had injury worries. He played as the second ruckman, the third ruckman. I don't even know. Certainly is not regarded as one of the top three ruckmen.
Might have made the bottom three.
Decided to go drink driving instead.
Big call number two was North Melbourne to struggle to make the eight. They came good eventually. Yes. They finished quite strongly. And they even made a prelim final. But to my credit, I think they did struggle for a
did
significant...
Did he say they struggled? I don't think I remember him saying they won't make the eight.
Yeah. No. They will struggle to make... Because
he's right.
This call is made with people picking them top four on the ladder.
No, you're right, Nick. You're
and
right,
I've gone, I think they'll be 7th, 8th, possibly 9th. You know, they finished 6th. I'll cop that one on the chin. Now, Josh.
Yes.
I think we're going to have to redefine big call next year because
These are big calls.
I think they're a little hard to judge, though, because we don't have conclusive answers on either of them.
And they're both about coaches. That's no fun.
Anyway, Josh.
Correct. Well, mine was Bomber Thompson will not be at Essendon next year. I don't believe he will be. Okay. I still don't believe he will be.
But we can't give you a ticker or a cross. We've got no idea.
We'll give him a cross.
We'll give him a cross.
Just for failure to meet the standards.
Just for benefit of the doubt.
And my other one was if North Melbourne don't make finals, Brad Scott will be out of a job.
We'll give you a cross for that one as well.
Well, they made the finals.
They did make the finals.
And Brad Scott won't be out of a job. So
that's all right.
My turn, boys. I've probably got the big call that was the worst one.
The worst.
I could not have overshot the mark by more. I said the Buddy will have an average year.
And he's had...
Now, I'll just wait for a while the people at home will stop... Until they stop laughing.
Yep. I think
I think they're done now.
Yep.
So, yes, I did think they would. And again, like Collingwood, about 5 or 6, 7 rounds in, I looked to be on the goods.
Yep.
Buddy was just off the mark. He didn't look to be his normal self. And yep. I looked like I was on the right track. He ended up finishing with the Coleman and the highest 4 goals in the grand final. So,
yep.
Not that. The Bulldogs top set 2... Two or more top 8 sides.
They've upset one top 8 side.
I agree with you.
Thank you.
Because the Gold Coast Suns were in the top 8 at
and
the
so were Collingwood.
Late in the year.
Are Collingwood a top 8 side?
They were in the top 8.
But are they a top 8 side?
At the time that Gold Coast beat them.
Because I'm pretty sure they finished 11th.
It was a top 8 upset when they beat them.
Oh, we'll call it.
I'll give it to you. Thank you.
Josh, we'll move on. Our favourite moments of 2014.
We'll race through these.
Yeah.
Boys, my first one is Matty Prittis winning the Brownlow. Pretty obvious one, but I still think it needs to be mentioned. The most humble man in the AFL, in my opinion.
Yep.
No one was more deserving. Second of all, Port's improvement. I really loved watching how much they came forward. All three of us had them outside of our top 8.
Yep.
Proved us all wrong big time. A lot of people think they'll win the grand final next year. Paddy Ryder's going over there. Johnny Giles might be, so you never know.
Yep.
Number 3, Nathan Fyfe.
Yep.
This guy is the heir apparent to Gary Ablett, in my opinion.
Okay.
Absolute star. Tagging him doesn't stop him. And there's nothing that this guy's bad at because he's now improving his kicking. And he'll have it fixed by next year.
My favourite moments of 2014. First one, round 18, St Kilda versus Fremantle. St Kilda has won that one by 58 points. It has ruined Fremantle's top 2 chances. And therefore ruined their...
What have you got to hear about Ross Lyon's arrogance?
Their premiership chances. Ross Lyon arrogance, I think, 2 years in a row, a bit of deja vu there, has cost them dearly. Second, Matt White's goal of the year. I absolutely love that goal.
Yes.
I think that was far and above the goal of the year the moment he kicked it, even though everyone's saying...
What about Marcus Bontempelli?
No, Bontempelli can keep walking because Matt White has waltzed around his opponent and kicked a beautiful goal there. The third one, bit of a Port Adelaide flavour, Jared Pollock. I thought he's had a terrific season at Port Adelaide. One of their best.
That's a good one.
While they were right at the top earlier in the season, he was one of their best. Come down from Brisbane and had a terrific year.
We're all about Port today.
I've always said this man is an absolute superstar. One more wobble for the year.
Okay.
Robbie Gray. I said at the beginning of last year that this guy is a very good footballer and it's just fantastic to see him get the recognition that he's getting now, being one of the best players in the competition.
Certainly is.
Maybe one more wobble.
No.
Luke Parker's emergence.
I remember you saying he's terrible and that he should be listed.
Oh, you're lying. he did a few years of apprenticeship under Jude Bolton. Yep. Jude Bolton now relinquished that role at the end of last year, and we saw this year he's just been an absolute phenomenal footballer. So he's probably expecting to go to the next step again next year. And number three, this is my favourite moment.
I was telling Nick on the way here that Essendon are probably one of the most overrated teams that I have seen playing AFL.
Who rates us?
I think that Essendon... Well, Essendon fans rate Essendon very highly. I think Essendon fans still feel that Essendon will make the finals.
I think coming into
which
this...
Which I think is a laughable joke if you think that Essendon can make the finals. If they do, play this at the end of the season and rip into me. But Essendon... If footy games were played for one half, Essendon would be premiers. Because they show up for a half, then they get their pillows out, yeah, they drink a warm glass of milk, and they go to sleep.
Now, Vinay.
Anything to say about it?
Anything to say?
Yes, I do have something to
we
say.
We got beaten in the elimination final, but
you still made them.
We still made them.
You still made them.
You look like a fool.
You made them. All right, you may or I don't have anything to say, I'll cop it, because I do like to make big calls, and then when I get them wrong, I do like to cop it. Well, I don't like to, but I reluctantly cop it on the chin. So I will, but just quietly, I think it does speak in volumes that your boys got just shoved out in the elimination final.
Doesn't speak any volumes, you were wrong.
Anyway, boys, just before we finish up, there's rumours flying all around the place
yep.
that where some big names in the competition are going to end up next season. One word answers, where are they going to be next year? Josh, who have you got for us?
Let's go, James Frawley.
Oh, what are we doing? We're going where
they're going.
Where's
he going?
Hawthorn.
Hawthorn, yep.
Hawthorn. He's just copying what I'm saying.
Patrick, well, I said it too. Patrick Dangerfield.
Adelaide.
Melbourne.
Jared Waite.
North Melbourne.
Geelong.
North Melbourne. Mitch Clark.
Geelong.
Collingwood.
Collingwood, okay.
Liam Jones.
McDonald's.
Oh, McDonald's. Yeah. I love it.
Carlton.
All right.
Jonathan Giles.
Port Adelaide.
Port Adelaide, yep.
Adelaide. Nick Malcheski.
Gold Coast.
Sydney.
Ooh.
Think you'll stay. Zach Clark.
McDonald's.
Fremantle? Mm-hmm.
Carlton. I'll go Carlton again.
Okay.
And Daniel Gorringe.
Essendon.
Whoever gives the best offer. I've got no idea.
I reckon Essendon.
Essendon. I'll say Essendon as well. All right, boys, that wraps it up for season 2014. It's been a massive, massive year. I've got a few thank yous to get through.
Yep.
And then we'll wrap it up. To the guys at Valley, I'm your favourite man.
Oh, I tell you what. So I'm not thanking them this time.
No, I'm doing it.
Josh has got it covered.
Matt and Jared at Valley Arm have been fantastic support all year. Helped us out with putting the video together and everything like that each and every week. They've been fantastic.
Yep.
To Justin, our producer, knows stuff all about football, but sits here each and every Monday night and helps us out. You've been fantastic, mate.
Thanks, Justin.
To my mum and dad, we've used their garage all season long.
Makeshift studio.
We'll hopefully improve next year.
We will.
On the studio, but they've been fantastic to let us use their house and garage for the entire year.
Certainly have.
All the boys in our little group that give the votes, let me just go through. I'm here, Daniel,
Sam,
Jackie, Daniel.
Anyway, there's 20 of them.
There's 20 of them. But you guys have been fantastic. To you two, the show wouldn't be the same without you two. So,
I certainly wouldn't.
Nick, to your editing skills, you've been fantastic. Vinay, just for your pure laughs all year long, have been outstanding.
And to you, Josh, you've been absolutely brilliant.
Thanks, mate. I appreciate it. And last but not least, the fans and the subscribers.
The number ones.
I think we're pushing 500 subscribers now.
Yeah, we're almost there.
So.
A tick over 75,000 views for the year. It's been absolutely terrific.
So to you guys who have been with us the entire time, we appreciate all the feedback that you give us. Make sure you tell all your friends and family about us. We want to progress to 1,000 subscribers by the start of next year. We will be doing... post-trade videos, pre and post-draft,
and
probably mid-January to early February.
We'll get started again. So if you haven't already subscribed, you've watched us a couple of times, hit the subscribe button. We'll greatly appreciate it. We'd appreciate your support.
Absolutely, boys. All right, that's it for us for a couple of weeks. We'll be back after the trade period.
We'll have an announcement on Twitter or Facebook to let you know when the next episode will be.
Absolutely. So, last but not least, congratulations to the Hawks. They were fantastic on Saturday. You two are unbelievable. We're just getting to the end of the year, I think.
Who? Hawthorne?
No.
Us.
No, okay. We're just getting there.
When you said where, I thought you meant
we're Hawthorne. Limping home.
We're limping home.
They're a happy team at Hawthorne. Yeah.
Been a fantastic year. It's been a fun-filled year. We will see you in a couple of weeks. As Nick said, we'll shout out a date on when the post-trade show will be out. So yep. Enjoy your off-season, whatever you're doing, and we'll see you when we see you.
Go Cats. Catch you later.
Go Bombers.
Go Eagles.